I was on my haunches, ready to tally up, when the shadow fell over the case full of coins and robbed them of their shine. Someone was standing close behind me. Cops? Please, I thought, not more cops. Was Wren going to be Paris all over again? With one hand I picked up my fiddle and bow from the warm cobblestones. With the other I thrust the money I'd already counted into my pocket. And then the stink reached down and told me who it really was. As I rose, I heard the muttered word, "Salut." I turned. He was young, probably younger than I was, and somehow that made it worse. "Salut," he hissed again. "Thief." The accusation was a hoarse croak that barely had the strength to escape from the matted mess of moustache and beard, but there was no mistaking its anger. A greasy hank of hair hung across his face as he swayed before me, but when his head lolled to one side it fell back and showed me his eyes, dull, glazed over with the effort of trying to focus his hate. The brow above the left one was a yellow and black bruise, fastened in place on the filthy skin by a web of bloody streaks. At the sight of it, pity almost overcame my weariness, but not quite, for I knew from bitter experience how unpredictable this kind of drunk could be. Till now he'd contented himself with a few shouted oaths from the other side of the square, but the bottle, which had been half full when I'd first seen him, was empty now. Determined to take no more chances, I drew my belongings further out of reach. "Espèce de con." This time it was a snarl, and then the sudden flaring of his nostrils doubled the warning. The grab was half-hearted, the hand slow, ready for violence, but unused to it. As I batted it away, I thought it might be better not to understand French. "I'm just making a few shillings, friend. Why don't you leave me alone?" I held out a 10-franc piece. He gave no sign of hearing or understanding, but this time the hand moved like lightning. Brows furrowed, he examined the coin with both hands, then polished its dullness on his sleeve. I watched it disappear into a ragged fold of jacket, and only once it was safe did he remember how much he hated me. He spat at my feet and began to shuffle back towards the fountain by the far wall, muttering, shaking his head, brandishing the empty bottle. Slowly I let myself relax, bending to pack away my things as I watched him. But as he sat down amid his pile of possessions, my relief died, for I saw what I'd missed before. A bow sticking out from the tattered knapsack. Beside it, wet with the fountain spray, a fiddle. He was a busker too, and he had a right to be angry. I'd stolen his pitch. I crossed the square in my turn. The aggression had left him now, but the paranoia which had replaced it was no less extreme. As I drew near, he cowered away, wrapping the jacket tight round him, hunching chin down over chest. I dug into my pocket and brought out a handful of the change I'd been so anxious to keep from him a few minutes before. As I dropped it into the hat that lay beside him, I nodded at his fiddle. "Here, I'm sorry, I never saw it." The indecision was pitiful. The eyes registered the money, but he was too frightened now to lift it. His mouth worked. He gripped the ragged lapels tighter and turned further away from me, waiting for the kick and the blow. I lifted his sodden violin from the puddle and held it out to him. It might have been a good instrument once, but now it was a wreck. No amount of filth could cover the cracks and cigarette burns. There were only 3 strings. "You should dry it. It won't play if it's wet." One eye looked up. Hesitantly, the arms began to loosen their straight jacket grip. He stared at my face as though he'd never seen it before. And then, as his gaze shifted, I realized I was still holding my own instrument. A longing came into his eyes. When he reached out again, it was towards my fiddle, not his. The grimy hand nearly closed on the ribbon of the silver St. Christopher that hung from the scroll, but I was fast enough. I thrust his own violin back at him. He scowled, spat. I backed off until I was out of his reach, then turned and walked away. My rudeness had been accidental. I'd made it good as best I could. It was time to go before his mood changed again. What could I do to help him anyway? I'd enough problems of my own without... Halfway across the square, the sound of his fiddle stopped me. I turned. He was sitting cross-legged on the fountain steps, scraping the almost hairless bow across the untuned strings, shaking his head from side to side in pathetic imitation of a jolly fiddler. The sound was an eerie mockery of music, the open-mouthed grin, an insane parody of merriment. Pity returned to me, only to be driven out by a familiar stab of fear. Was that me, a few years down the road? The thought was scary. For 4 years now, ever since leaving Scotland behind, I had been a busker. A professional one, if that word meant anything, making my living on the streets of Europe. Trouble with the law had pushed me into the life, but I'd quickly discovered how much I loved it, and I knew I'd never be anything else. But there was no escaping the one hard fact. It wasn't a job which came with pensions and cosy retirement schemes. So was that my future? A stretch of pavement to rule from a wet stone step? A doorway to sleep in? Madness? Even though I was strong now, I'd been near madness once, near enough to fear it more than anything. I knelt, let the ritual of putting away the fiddle banish the thought. And then I lifted the case, turned my back on him, and lost no time leaving the square. I strode off down the narrow street of medieval half-timbered houses that would lead me back towards the town centre. The city of Rennes was giving them a facelift, sanitising its heritage, renovating the crumbling facades for tourist eyes, and hammer and drill soon drowned all other sound, musical or otherwise. For that, I was grateful, and I was thankful for the shade as well, for the afternoon sun was hot enough to work its usual paradox, sticking my wet shirt to the small of my back and my dry tongue to the roof of my mouth. When a waiter appeared from one of the nearby cafes and began weaving through the scaffolding, my eyes followed his tray. The single frosted glass in it seemed cruel, a mockery of my thirst, intensifying all the grimy city tastes I'd collected in the last few hours. Just one beer, I thought. One really cold beer. But I marched on, for I could afford neither the time nor the cash. I had a deadline, and since leaving the north my luck had been doing its best to stop me keeping it. The place I was headed for was Concarneau, a small town on Brittany's south coast. I'd planned to make my way there from Germany at a leisurely pace, working just enough to make ends meet. A week's busking, I'd figured, would be ample to take care of petrol and give me enough for a few days of simple living. Or at least that had been the theory. It was the run-in with the Paris metro cops which had changed everything. 6 hours in their gendarmerie's carbolic stink had been bad enough, but the fiddle case, which had been full of money when they took me in, came back empty when they let me go, and argument would have been suicide. And then the next day, just past Chartres, my ageing Fiat decided I'd ignored its overheating long enough. The new radiator had been ruinously expensive, doubly so, for I'd had to wait a day and a half for it to reach the village where I'd broken down, and there was nowhere to busk. The upshot of it all was that I was in a near penniless state which only the street could cure. And though my one morning in Rennes had shown me how generous the Bretons could be, I knew it was going to take a long time to get enough money together for my needs. It was worrying, but not as worrying as the fact that I was already 3 days late. Tonight I'd phone. I had to phone. I turned into an alleyway, hoping to avoid the press of people and find a shortcut to the main shopping street, the Rue d'Orléans. As I walked, I reached into my back pocket for the letter which had found me just before I left Germany. It was from the woman who had given me the St. Christopher. Her name was Ellie. She was 37 years old, she was Dutch, she was calm and beautiful, and she was a problem. For nearly 7 years now, we'd tried to force the love we felt for each other into some kind of permanence. We'd tried living with each other, we'd tried living without each other, and neither option had left us satisfied. More than a month in one place left me feeling shackled. More than a month without me left her feeling abandoned. It seemed insoluble, but we'd been apart now since early spring, and the letter's arrival had made me realise how much I missed her. I stopped beside a bright swathe of anti-nuclear posters and read the few lines again. She was spending a couple of days in Brittany. She'd rented a cottage miles from anywhere. Did I want to come for a while, talk things through? The phone number was a bar in Concarneau. I'd left a message to say I'd arrive by Sunday the 20th of July, and today was already Wednesday the 23rd. I put the crumpled envelope away again, cursing myself. When the troubles with the cops and the car had started, I should have phoned again, but I'd put it off. I'd feared that it would sound like an evasion, an excuse. But if today's takings didn't give me enough to fill the tank, I'd do it. I had to. If I didn't... I turned the corner and felt instinct override the familiar arguments. A street without cars. A pedestrian precinct. And a prosperous one at that. Boutiques, perfumeries, cafes, it looked right. I cut through the crowd to the next intersection. and smiled with satisfaction when I reached it. Better than just right, much better. A bywater of the main Rue d'Orléans concourse, a nice little carless crossroads, shaded by a cluster of tall shrubs planted in concrete pots. It was a natural place for people to stop, and the shrubs were a double bonus, for as well as affording me shade, they'd give privacy to those who preferred to open their purses discreetly. Nearly four now, no time to lose. I opened the case, lifted the violin, and started to play. And after 5 minutes, I knew I had a gold mine. Women. If the world was really split according to the myth of the sexual divide, then no busker would be crazy enough to choose the male half for an audience. It's not a question of generosity. Both sexes have that. It's a question of accessibility. Men rule their world by subduing it, women by gauging it. And gauging it means that they perceive more of it. Men take stock of their environment as and when they need to, but women judge to a fine point how and where they fit into things. They continually assess and reassess the relationship between themselves and their surroundings. It doesn't make them better or worse than their male counterparts, but it does mean that they pick up stimuli faster, that they're better at perceiving than you. And on the street, that simply means that something out of the usual stands more of a chance of being noticed, of making its living. And here, it was obvious that the living could be very good indeed. For the kind of women who were bending to drop money into my fiddle case were doing it with a dainty sideways swivel of the knees, dictated by the tightness of their skirts and the height of their heels. Sophisticated, older women, droves of them, and with money to burn. I'd struck it lucky. It wasn't hard to see what was drawing them. The boutiques surrounding me were devoted to fashion, but there was none of the usual scramble for a share of the almighty teenage purse. Across the four corners, Louis Vuitton and Hermes challenged each other with umbrella and handbag, and two old-fashioned dress shops gave themselves airs and tried to think of themselves as couturiers, competing with understated refinement, a single gown in each of their windows unsullied by the mention of anything as vulgar as price. And as far as the eye could see in every direction, the stylish displays craned forward to seduce. Gloves, hats, shoes, jewellery, makeup to create mystique, perfume to perpetuate it, luxury lotions to pamper from bath to bedroom. One word came irresistibly to mind. Cornucopia. Every window was a horn of plenty, every doorway practically a command to dally. I played. The case filled quickly and the fact obviously had nothing to do with my music. I was a fixture, a talking point, just like the wares in the windows. To some of the women, I was an excuse to peruse the shoe shop beside me. To others, the shoe shop was the pretext, and I was the object of scrutiny. I could see them speculate, trying to classify me. What was I? Just another beggar? Or something more exotic? A fin de saison special offer? Worth a closer look? The ones who decided I was used my case to get it, and to buy themselves a few coppers worth of admiration at the same time. A franc for the chance of showing off a pretty pair of ankles, a neck as yet unlined by age. It was a bargain, with flirtation thrown in free. Once it was done, they smiled with satisfaction at their own daring, snapped their handbags shut, and went on their way. I didn't mind. It was harmless, and as the perfumed coin rained down into my case, I enjoyed them in my turn, and not just for their money or their looks. I liked the care with which they took their expensive ease. They were painstaking in their perusal, unhurried in their search for a lavish bargain, sure in their judgment of what suited. Older or not, they were no less devoted to fashion than they'd been 10 years before, or 20. But it was all less frenetic now. They'd learned discrimination, and this clever little corner knew how to help them exercise it, how to emphasise the fact that there was as much to look forward to as to look back on. Plenty of well-tailored elegance to show Madame how striking she could still look. Cashmere, silk and lace to promise her tomorrow's finesse, but no jean shops to remind her of yesterday's waistline. The single dress in the window would make her 10 years younger if she wanted to surprise, or 10 lives older if she wanted to seduce. I played, I watched, and wondered what the men made of it all. The odd briefcase went by, but hurriedly, as though its owner knew he had no place here without a chaperone, and when the waiter I'd seen earlier passed me again, en route to his home base at the next corner's cafe, he frowned, as though he held the territory's sole franchise for unattached masculinity. But a few signs of male independence did exist, albeit with suitable discretion. Brass plates announced the presence of Monsieur le Notaire or Monsieur le Médecin in the sober grey upper stories. Did they only come out after dark? I smiled at the fantasy as I looked up into the first floor apartment opposite. Through the open window I heard a man's voice answer the telephone and saw a striped cuff reach up to draw the blind. It lingered long after the job was done, and I wondered, was I being listened to, or were the women being watched? The answer came immediately. A shapely pair of legs sauntered past me. As soon as they disappeared round the corner, the hand vanished, and I smiled at my own vanity. An audience, and money, that would be too much to expect. I stopped, put the fiddle down, and knelt to gather the take. 100, 10, 20, 30. As I counted the coin, my eyes found the St. Christopher. Had it finally worked, changed my luck? Were things going right for me at last? And the minute I stood up again, I knew they were. In front of me stood two boys and three girls, each with a shiny black violin case. Now, any good busker knows how to capitalize on kids. But 10 or 11-year-olds who were musicians as well, and fiddlers to boot, that was a heaven-sent opportunity. Immediately, people began to stop, intrigued by the confrontation. Within minutes, I was surrounded by a semicircle of expectant faces. Once more, I played. A set of reels, fast and flashy. The Devil's Dream and an American tune, Whiskey Before Breakfast. A slow air and Strathspeys. A hornpipe called Wrapped Up Tidy. At the end of each piece, for I kept them short to milk the situation, the children applauded. All except the sixth, the one I hadn't noticed arriving. His violin case was different from the others, one of the beautiful old Morocco leather ones that I'd always wanted. And he held it in front of him with both hands, shyly. I was reaching him, though. His eyes told me so. He had an insight into my music. I always knew when someone did, when they understood from the heart, when it was more than just entertainment. But I resisted the temptation to play just for him, for the longer I could keep all the children, the better business would be.